to Hong Kong and where my father was and make them proud of me. But it was the worst year that I spent in my life in Hong Kong.
So you apply to a hospital, a Presbyterian?
Yes, in Philadelphia.
In Philadelphia.
And then I came to America. And America essentially was, to me, truly the brave new world.
Yeah. Now, you meet your husband. How did you meet Bob?
I met Bob. I had a first marriage, which was extremely unhappy. And one of my colleagues, an American woman called Alcinous Crawford, she was 30 years older than I was. And she said that you should meet somebody that that she knew. And that she's the one, she passed away now, but she was the one who introduced us.
Where were you married, and did your family come to the wedding?
No, we had a very, very small wedding, and in Pacific Beach in Northern California.
Yeah. Now you keep going back to China, though, and you bring your sister Lydia together with your stepmother. They had been totally, I guess, enemies at that point.
Yes. My stepmother did not want us to help our sister. But I thought my sister was left behind in China.
In communist China.
In communist China, and she went through the Cultural Revolution. And I felt extremely sorry for her. So I tried to help her and help her children to go to school in America. And but I knew that by going against my stepmother, that she would not be pleased. But I felt it was my duty to help my sister, and I did so. And I tried to reconcile them, but it was to my detriment that I did so.
Absolutely. After the stepmother is dead, you discover the sister had been writing letters.
Yes.
And you read them, and it is all how terrible you are.
Yes.
And the whole sort of like a spy.
Yes. Unfortunately, I trusted my own sister. I did not know that she had an ulterior motive. And she wanted to reconcile with my stepmother, not because she loved my stepmother or my father, who was senile at the time, but only because she wanted to get part of the inheritance.
For 6 years, your father is in the Hong Kong sanitarium.
Yes.
When he dies, stepmother has had everything put in her name.
Yes.
And you go, and the will is there, and Mr. Liu says, don't bother turning a page. There's your father died penniless.
Yes, in fact, this is how the book Falling Leaves starts. We were all summoned back for the reading of my father's will after he died in 1988. Yeah. And we sat around this table in Prince's Building in Hong Kong next to the Mandarin Hotel. And we were all each given a copy of the will. But then the lawyer stands up, and after the first page, reading the first page, I mean, which just says his name and address and so on, and said, your stepmother has something to say to you. And she stands up and says, there's no need for you to go on reading the will because your father died penniless. And she held out her hand, and all of us, even though we were all successful and adults, I mean, in our 50s, she held out her hand, and we each gave back the copy of our father's will, unread. Yes, that was the power she had over us.
Now, in her later years, and obviously she has colon cancer, you are a doctor.
Yes.
You are practicing in America.
Yes.
And you offer to have her come here to be operated on. Mm-hmm. And first she says yes, because she knows that the era is coming to a close for Hong Kong.
Yes.
She did buy a condominium in San Francisco.
Yes, in Nob Hill, in San Francisco.
What has happened to that since?
One of my brothers owns that now.
Uh-huh.
But she begged me on her deathbed to come to Hong Kong, take her on a plane, because she wanted to die in my house in California. And I was very, very touched, because I thought that finally she has accepted me.
Yeah.
And then she died. And later on, I found out that she had disinherited me. And the only reason she asked me to take her to die in my house was because she had a green card. And she knew that if she had come to this country, then the government would have taken half of it, and my siblings would have hated me for it. And that was the reason she begged me to take her to die in my house.
But you go back to her funeral, and not one friend, this has been a socialite of Hong Kong, No one comes to her funeral.
Not a single person, yes.
Yeah.
This is what happened.
And mm-hmm. your brother, who is called James in the book, says, look, I'm her executor. You have been disinherited. If you fight, the only one who's going to get money are the lawyers. I'll give you 10%.
5%.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And your sister Lydia says, I wouldn't give you a nickel.
That is correct.
You wouldn't have had it if you hadn't fought.
Well, it was really strange because we had not read our father's will. Remember that until my stepmother died. And when I found out that I had been disinherited, I was heartbroken. And I wanted to find my father's will to find out whether my father had disinherited me also.
Yeah.
And then my husband and I went to her apartment. In her bedroom, full of her smell, her clothes, her memories. And there I found my father's will.
Bob finds it.
And Bob found my father's will. And it was such a relief to me to know that my father loved me and has given me the same share as my brothers.
Yeah.
And that was a wonderful moment. Yes.
Tell me, Adeline, you have children. How, if you had no role model as a mother, how did you learn to be a mother?
I really, looking back, of course, I've lived a long time, Connie. I'm 68 years old.
Okay, I thought you were 40.
No, okay. No. Yeah. But I've lived a long time, and I felt towards my children that I would want them to have all the advantages, or the really all the advantages that I was disadvantaged with, rather.
Yeah.
And I gave in to them in whatever way that I felt I was deprived of when I was a child. And this is how I tried to bring them up.
Because reading the book, there was no one who gave what I would call body comfort to this. You know, I haven't liked the cover of this book because to me, here is little Adeline and the rest of the family are in background.